Hi everybody, welcome back. Hang in there. We only have one more test that we need to learn, and that's the chi-square test for independence. This particular chapter actually covers two chi-square tests. One is called the chi-square goodness of fit test, and the other is the chi-square test for independence. They both use the exact same formula. They're both based on the exact same logic. It's just that the chi-square goodness of fit test is based on one variable, and the chi-square test for independence is based on trying to find an association between two variables, and we're going to focus on that. So let's go ahead and jump right in. All the tests that we've learned so far are known as parametric tests, and that's because there's an underlying population parameter that we're trying to estimate. So remember, we would collect data from a sample, and we would compute a sample mean, x bar, but we were really trying to learn about the underlying population mean, mu. Or when we were correlating data from two different samples, we would compute a sample correlation, r. But what were we really trying to learn about? The population correlation, rho. As you've learned, when we do parametric tests, there are underlying assumptions that need to be true, or else we can't really trust the validity of the test. The good news is that chi-square tests are from a family of tests known as nonparametric tests. We're not trying to estimate any population parameter when we do a chi-square test. And as a result, there are no assumptions about the shape of the underlying distribution, and that's one reason that chi-square tests are often referred to as distribution-free tests, because we're not worried about the underlying distribution of the data. I mentioned that there are two chi-square tests that are discussed in this chapter, and we're going to focus just on one. They're both basically the same. They both use the same formula. What we're trying to do with the chi-square test is compare our observed data, the data we actually have, with data that we would expect to find. And specifically, we're going to be trying to test to see if there's a relationship between two variables. So we'll be looking at our observed data, the data we actually collected, and we'll compare it with data that we would expect to find if there was no relationship at all between the two variables. If there are no differences between that observed data, the actual data we've collected, and the expected data, the data we would expect if there's no relationship between the two variables, then the chi-square value we compute would equal zero. But if differences exist between our observed data and the data we would expect if there was no relationship at all, then the chi-square statistic will increase in value. You might want to underline the word increase right here. And that's because chi-square values always need to be positive. If they don't equal zero, they're going to go up in value. And that makes sense if you look at the formula. I mentioned that we were comparing observed frequencies, that's F sub O, with expected frequencies, that's F sub E. And then when we look and compute to see how big that difference is, we always square that value. So that's one reason why we call this a chi-squared test. And of course, anytime you square something, the value that results is going to be positive. So, long story short, chi-square values are always positive values. But for right now, we just want to ask ourselves, how big does that chi-square value need to be in order to rule out chance as a viable explanation for our results? Of course, we're going to compare our obtained chi-square statistic, the chi-square value that we compute, with a chi-square critical value. So let's talk about that next. Like we've seen before, critical values are based on the degrees of freedom. We are not going to be doing this chi-square goodness of fit test, so if you want, you can just go ahead and cross that out. But I'll just explain real quickly, the degrees of freedom for it are based on the number of columns in our table, minus one. What we're going to be doing is the chi-square test for independence. And remember, we're going to be looking at two variables to see if there's a relationship between those two variables. One variable in our table will be listed in the columns, and one variable in our table will be listed in the rows. So it's really easy to compute degrees of freedom for a chi-square test. We just look at our table, we see how many rows we have in our table, we subtract one. We see how many columns we have in our table, we subtract one, and then we multiply those two things. Now, it just so happens in pretty much every example we're going to do in class, we are going to have two rows and two columns. That means we're going to end up with 1 times 1, or 1 overall, degrees of freedom. Just like we've talked about in the past, the distribution is going to change shape based on the degrees of freedom. And if the distribution is going to keep changing its shape based on the degrees of freedom, so is that critical region in there. So in order to find out a critical value, we need to compute degrees of freedom. Here's just a little piece of a chi-square table. You can see it lists degrees of freedom going down this column right here. And then it also lists a variety of alpha levels. Most of these we would never use, but people in different disciplines do use those values. We typically use 0.05 as an alpha level, or maybe 0.01. And if most of our examples are going to have 1 degree of freedom, we can see this first row right here lists 1 degree of freedom. And as we come down right here, if we had an alpha of 0.05, our critical value would be 3.84. And if we used an alpha of 0.01, our critical value would be 6.63. And that's only a positive value, just a positive value. Because as we mentioned before, chi-square values can only be positive. In this example, we have 2 degrees of freedom. So now we would just look at our table. We'd look at this column. We'd find the row labeled with 2 degrees of freedom. We'd come across to the column listing an alpha level of 0.05. And you can see the critical value would be 5.99. Let me show you the full table real quickly. You've probably printed it out already. So again, right here, we see degrees of freedom 1, alpha 0.05, and 3.84 marks off the critical region. So that part's going to be really easy. Let's continue talking about chi-square. I mentioned that we're going to be testing to see if there are relationships between variables, and we've done that in the past. We need to make sure we understand what makes chi-square unique. So let's talk about what we already know. In the past, when we were measuring relationships between variables, we were specifically looking at relationships between quantitative variables, measurement variables, numerical variables. All those things mean essentially the same thing. And in those situations, we were computing a Pearson's R value. What makes things different with the chi-square test for independence is that now we're trying to determine if there's a relationship between variables that are non-numerical. Sometimes we call that data qualitative data. And in our course, we'll typically call it categorical data. So all those three things mean essentially the same thing as well. So here are just a few examples of that type of data. So a person might be categorized as a male or a female. There's nothing numerical about that. There are no numbers in place. Somebody might pass a course or fail a course. Again, there are no numbers in place. The way I'm measuring this is just in terms of success. They passed or they failed. They're put into one of those two categories. Now, we can have more than two categories. For right now, I'm just trying to keep things simple. So the chi-square test for independence is going to be the test that we want if I'm trying to figure out, for example, if there's a relationship between a student's gender, male or female, and whether or not they pass a statistics class. So do you see in that situation we have two variables? One is the student's gender, and one is whether they pass or fail the course. And both of those variables are non-numerical. Both of those variables are categorical because people are simply placed in categories. There are no numbers with numerical meaning that we're using. A person's either a male or a female, and a person either passes or fails the course. So what makes chi-square very different is that we're dealing with nominal data or ordinal data. We're not dealing with interval or ratio scale data. We're dealing with names of categories, typically. So as I mentioned, some people refer to this as categorical data. That makes a lot of sense. Some people refer to it as frequency data because I simply want to know the frequency or number of people who are in any particular category. Like how many males pass the class? How many females pass the class? I'm simply looking at the frequencies within each category. Some people even call it count data, because again, we're just counting the frequencies. So I'm just trying to make sure you're familiar with some of the terms that are used to describe these analyses. And just like that R value that we just learned how to compute previously, the chi-square value that we're going to compute today measures the strength of the relationship between two variables. Let's focus just a little bit more now on that chi-square test for independence. I mentioned that we're going to put our data into tables. These are the tables I'm talking about. And we call these contingency tables. And specifically, these are 2x2 contingency tables. I'll explain that in a moment. For this chi-square test, I'm always asking myself, are two categorical variables related? Is there a relationship between those two variables? So for example, is smoking status related to cancer status? Let's use that as an example. This top table right here represents our observed data. So write down observed right over here. We call it our observed data because that's the data we've actually collected if we were involved in a research study. So in this particular situation, we measured 100 people. And you're going to find on these tables, our sample size, our overall N, is always listed in that lower right corner. And you can see that one variable is listed in the rows and one variable is listed in the columns. This variable is smoking status, and people can be placed into one of two categories. They either smoke or they don't smoke. The second variable is cancer status, and again, people can be placed in one of two categories. They're diagnosed with cancer, or they're diagnosed as not having cancer. So do you see in this table, there are two important rows and two important columns? That's why I refer to this as a 2x2 contingency table. And that becomes important because you might remember when we were talking about degrees of freedom is based on the size of the table. So I need to be able to look at that table and understand there are two important columns and two important rows. Nonetheless, when you look at that table, you might be thinking to yourself, that looks a lot like a 3x3 table. But the only reason it looks like a 3x3 table is because I added a row for the totals, and I also added a column for the totals. That's not actual data. Those are just summary statistics. But those summary statistics are really very helpful to us. So we can see here in our research study that included 100 people, 46 of these people were diagnosed as having cancer. 54 people do not have cancer. We had 50 smokers, 50 non-smokers. That information is going to be very important to us. But what's most important to the analysis are these cells right in here. Because I'm able to see now at a glance very easily how many people are smokers diagnosed with cancer, how many people are smokers without cancer, how many people are non-smokers diagnosed with cancer, and how many people are non-smokers diagnosed as not having cancer. So this is my actual data. This is my observed data. And if you look closely enough, you can start to see that although we measured 50 smokers and 50 non-smokers, so in other words, an equal number of smokers and non-smokers, it's looking like smokers are more likely to have cancer. But how do these numbers actually need to look for me to say there's a statistically significant relationship between those two variables? That's where this next table comes into play. This table shows the frequencies that we would expect to find if there was absolutely no relationship between those two variables, smoking status and cancer status. So right over here, write expected. Check one, check one, check one, check one. In a future video, I'm going to show you how we can compute these expected values, but for right now, let's just take a look at them and make sure we understand what they represent. Some of the numbers from the table above just follow us to the table below. For example, there are 46 people in our research study who are diagnosed with cancer. That's a fact. That can't change. There are 54 people in our research study diagnosed as not having cancer. Again, that's a fact. That doesn't change. There are 50 smokers in our study, 50 non-smokers in our study. That's a fact. That doesn't change. So these totals all follow us along. What we are asking ourselves in this situation is, how would these frequencies be distributed among these four cells if there was absolutely no relationship between smoking and cancer? I'm going to show you how to compute those values mathematically, but right now let's just talk about it intuitively so you can actually understand it. Remember, I measured an equal number of smokers, 50 of them, and non-smokers, 50 of them. If there's absolutely no relationship between smoking and cancer, then these 46 cases of cancer should be equally split between the smokers and the non-smokers. I assume that that should make sense to you. This would show the exact same amount of smokers are diagnosed with cancer as non-smokers. No relationship between smoking and cancer. If I know you smoke, it doesn't help me predict if you have cancer or not. And this is where the game begins. This is where the chi-square analysis gets interesting. What we are going to do is compare our actual data, this observed data, with the data we would expect to find if there's no relationship at all. If our observed data is very close to this expected data, then there's no evidence that there's a relationship between the two variables. But if our observed data is quite different from our expected data, then there is good evidence that there is a relationship between the two variables. Because remember, this table right here shows what we would find if there's no relationship. If this table is quite different, there must be a relationship. And I'll show you how to compute the chi-square statistic by comparing these two tables. But of course, we will do that in a later video. For right now, I just wanted to introduce you to the chi-square test for independence. That's it for now. I'll see you in the next video.